Have you ever felt completely lost inside a giant text file? Wait, let me make this scene even worse. What if all that text was actually unparsed JSON? You open it up, your screen is just a wall of brackets and quotes. You know, the answer is buried in there somewhere. Trying to find it is literally the definition of finding a needle in a haystack. I remember this one time I was staring at a massive log file from a server, thousands and thousands of lines of nested JSON. All I needed to do was to find one specific request ID we knew for a fact caused some issues. It was so large, online JSON parsers froze trying to handle it. I spent hours scrolling and gripping my way through different parts of copy text. My eyes started to hurt and I felt like I was getting absolutely nowhere. Over the last decade, I probably wasted hundreds of hours doing exactly that. Here's a fun fact. According to research, your brain can only really hold about 4 pieces of information at one time. When you try to manually track nested data, you're forcing your brain to do something it just isn't built for. Now, most people think you have 2 bad options, either search manually and get a headache or waste time writing scripts to parse the file, but that's not the whole story. There's one tool that lets you speak the language of JSON directly from your command line, JQ. But JQ isn't just a tool or a CLI, it's a full-blown language. It's a combination of sed, grep, and awk, but for JSON. I'm not just talking about finding a value, I'm talking about filtering, manipulating, and bending any JSON data to your will with a single command. I'm going to show you how to use JQ to make you feel like you have superpowers. JQ, as we already established, isn't just a command line utility. It's a very high-level programming language handling JSON, which, just for context, stands for JavaScript Object Notation, but as most of you probably already know, is used by most web systems and is the default way to send and receive data using REST APIs. JQ was first released on October 2012 by Stephen Dolan, attempting to create the famous Unix utility sed, but for JSON. There's a Go implementation called GoJQ, which also extends JQ to support YAMLs. There's another way to do that, and much more. We'll get there. Another port, obviously, is written in Rust because you can't have a tool that isn't rewritten using the crab lang. Jack's goal is to be faster and more correct, whatever this means. Last but not least, since JQ is a programming language, after all, JQ is a JQ implementation in, well, yeah. I should print that on a t-shirt. JQ is a lightweight and flexible command line JSON processor, as they put it, like sed, but for JSON data. If you've noticed, the URL is JSON lang, and though their page doesn't mention it, JQ is a programming language, a very much specific, narrow-scoped, high-level one, but a language nevertheless. If somehow you don't already have JQ installed, there's binaries for download available for every package manager in existence. And it works like this. In front of you, there's a JSON describing the best startup team I know of, led by Richard Hendricks. There are some startup information, location, and a team holds the array of team members. Now, mind you, this JSON is already prettified by Neovim and then saved into a JSON file with nice structure. JQ takes a reference, in this case, dot is entire object, and the file to read or stream to input. We get a color-coded JSON output. Nice, but not life-changing. And this is where the language kicks in. Let's get the team, for example. This is an array of members. Just by asking for .team, we get the list surrounded by array brackets. But JQ comes with an iterator. Empty brackets is basically asking for all objects, and there they are, one after the other. But here's where it gets fancy. First, we can ask for a specific object, as one would imagine in an array, which is nice. However, leaving the index clear and then asking for a name, for example, gets the iterator to extract only relevant names from each object in the array of team members. One notable hidden feature, which is especially useful when scripting with JQ, is stripping the result from surrounding quotes using the raw data flag like so. Now, before moving forward, let's make it clear. JQ takes any kind of input, stream, or files, you can echo raw JSON, then pipe it over to JQ and you get a parsed, structured, color-coded data. Always. This becomes even more critical when fetching raw data with curl, like the JQ project's commits from GitHub, for example. This nasty, unreadable information can be sent to the tool and voila. As mentioned, go as deep as you like. Take the first item and restructure the keys with your own object, like a message holding the commit message or a name holding the commit.committer.name. Is your company's AI a tangled mess of different tools and systems? That's what they call AI sprawl, and it makes everything more complicated, less secure, and much slower. But there's a simpler way. Meet Area. They've built an enterprise platform that brings all your AI together in one place, making it easy to manage and use. With Area, teams can build AI agents fast. They have no code tools and pre-built templates, so anyone can create a solution, not just engineers. But for those who do code, Area also supports custom Python development, so everyone can build their agents their way. Here's the best part. Area is model agnostic. That means they don't force you to use one AI model. You have the freedom to pick and switch between the best ones for each job, saving you money and improving performance without having to rebuild anything. Plus, Area connects directly to your company's data and systems. This makes sure your AI has the right information while keeping it secure. Once you've built something great, you can share it with the Area community. Browse ready-made agents and templates and jumpstart your next project with ideas from other builders. Stop the AI sprawl, get your AI under control with Area. Visit area.ai to start your free trial. Now, back to the video. JQ comes with some useful flags. We've seen minus R for raw input, removing all surrounding notation. Hyphen C for compact compresses the structure back to its condensed line form. As with other languages, when addressing an array, you can select range-based elements. But JQ's real power is its internal functions. A useful one is the length of objects, which is nice, but you haven't seen selection yet. With select, we can do all sorts of stuff, such as picking the team members whose salary is over 115K and boom, Jared Dunn is off the list. Flipping the operator does what you think it would. There's of course also the usual operators of equal, not equal, to work with when selecting and filtering. Now of course, this is a simple example. Take this to the world of application logs or load balancer access logs if you ever had the pleasure to search through one, and you start realizing the power of this thing. I can't even begin to tell you how many hours I managed to burn slicing and grepping long JSON files as if they were raw text and banging my head with frustration. So far, we've just selected a few objects. What if we want to clear unnecessary data? I mean, seriously, think about the power of it. Check this out. I can select the team's list, but delete the skills to clean the result. Much better. Wanna clean further? Just pipe it on and delete more keys. Okay, that's rather simple. When things get more complicated, especially when scripting, JQ allows you to set arguments. For example, we can define that N is for Dinesh, then select a name from the team where it matches the parameter N. But what if you're unsure of the structure and need to explore it a little? Keys gets you, well, the keys of an object, which can also be applied to a nested item like a list. Now, remember the structuring option lets use the PyPiper team to build an object. I'll use a new key called person for the name. Then a skill would be they can do, and pick a skill, but only the first one on every list. And there I have pairs for team member and skills. The has function will return a boolean based on the existence of a key. So stutterup isn't part of this JSON, but startup very much is. If we want to select only team members who have the coding skill on their tool belt, we can use whatever is indexed for that. And while code isn't exactly there, Java is Dinesh's superpower. Okay, this is child's play. Let's run a real world scenario with a proper humongous JSON file like you've all once seen before. This is a stream of logs, thankfully structured in JSON, but completely unreadable. Grepping this thing for a specific message is quite literally looking for a needle in a haystack. Sending them to JQ without touching is already miles better, even if you're grepping things. However, if we dig in, starting from noticing we're looking at an array of messages, we start with 6,502 lines. Now, yes, it's not the amount of messages, still, check this out. We'll get the first object keys. Inside details, there's another nested object. Let's say we want all the lines with latency larger than the arbitrary 4422 just because it's the first element on the left. Got it. Now let's count. We're at 858. And again, not objects. There is a way to count the objects themselves by piping a real countable dataset like an array to the length function. Reading everything, piping to length, gives us 500 objects of log lines in total. However, running it after the latency gives us a weird long list of sixes, which is the number of keys in each object. Not quite what we need. An easy fix is to wrap the result in list brackets, like so. Now, the length will count the number of returned objects. 66 of them. Oftentimes, especially with logs, you'd want to filter a log level. So just like we plucked Jared from PyPiper earlier, this time we use the comparison operator for warning lines or errors. Miles better than grepping error, like I've probably done thousands of times in my life. We've already established the fact that this is a programming language, and as such, it recognizes regular expressions, mathematical operators and results. It can have parameters and assignments, which we've used earlier. It even has comments and conditionals. Since you can grab all of it in the docs, I want to talk to you about the elephant in the room. More like three elephants, to be honest. The first is JQ ports. As with many other utilities, JQ is popular enough to have forks that are also quite popular, noticeably in Go and Rust. Let's start with the first. GoJQ is a pure JQ implementation in Go, installable through all popular package managers and basically used like JQ with a few minor differences. You'll find all the usuals, but here's what caught my eye. JQ errors are not very friendly, to say the least. GoJQ aims to reconcile this with friendly explanations pointing exactly where the problem lies and hints heavily to help you fix the prompt. The other reason one may consider to opt for GoJQ is the standard yet missing YAML support from JQ itself. Add YAML input to the flags and there we are, a parsed output. You can keep querying as normal, like there's no difference. And you've probably noticed all of this was sent back as JSON. So if you're also interested in the output, add YAML output as well, and there it is. There are a few other differences to consider, all listed in the project. But I don't use GoJQ. I could, but I find it much easier to use the other elephant in the room, YQ, a parser for, well, you guessed it. A very popular project, which by the way also handles JSONs, XML, CSVs, TOMLs, and others, which are all relatively new. Not quite adhering to the Unix philosophy like JQ, but that's beside the point. It was originally a JQ for YAMLs, and a quick look at the usage tells the story. Same syntax, concepts, and everyday use, so you can pick it up without thinking too much. It parses the data, color codes like JQ would, can iterate objects, use advanced functions like deletions, and chain further queries, just like its spiritual father would. Now, before moving to the grand finale, there are two small utilities that not enough people know, especially JQ users, and it's a shame they don't. JQP is a tool written in Go and essentially builds JQ into a dynamic UI that makes JQ querying so much easier. It takes JSON in stdin from where you can freely query an object, go further and further again, backwards, or change the query. No command line reruns, the object is always visible in front of you on the left pane. Simple but genius. Its sibling, Gron, built by a really cool bug bounty hunter who happens to love Go by the name Tom Hudson, comes in where you either don't have time for JQ or just need to flatten the data, and it does exactly that. Throw JSON in and it lays flat in greppable entries, hence its name, greppable JSON. A poor man's JQ, if you will. I still very much am using JQ in scripts, automation servers, CI pipelines, and every once in a while when I need a quick extraction. However, I don't use GoJQ or YQ or Gron, and some of you can probably guess why. So finally, here's the last elephant in the room, Nuxtl. And before I'll show you just how big of an elephant Nuxtl really is, especially when talking about JQ, I will remind you that I have a couple of videos discussing the basics, advanced features, but also pros and cons and when you should consider adopting it. It is still, despite some drawbacks, my local daily driver, but it's not for everyone. Here's the gist of it. When you open a JSON file with Nuxtl, you literally get the keys in a table. It'll even suggest the nested objects for you to further query. Pipe it to the next function like getTeam, and the output is already structured in a table. Need a filter? Well, the syntax can't get any easier than this. Where salary is, adding an operator and a comparison target. It can convert to and from JSON, YAML, and any other format you can think of. One important caveat, while Nuxtl is awesome, it's not a full-blown programming language. You can't do anything you want with it, like you can with JQ, and it's made to make your life easier when working with data. Just to prove this point, a quick re-mention to JQ. Yeah, the JQ in the Power of 3 project. JQ is an absolute JSON superpower, but if you find yourself using it almost every day, I'd take a serious look at Nuxtl on this next video. It's a shell for data, reads JSON natively as well as other formats, and puts it into a queryable structure that makes it a breeze to read. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.